So, before we get into a more robust discussion about what an anti-poverty strategy should look like, the government and our party and Parliament has not waited for the results of that study to begin acting. I think that we understand that single parents who are struggling to make ends meet need a response immediately. They don't need a study, they need real programs. We know that Indigenous people who face obviously higher rates of unemployment, incarceration, less likely to obtain post-secondary education, lower health outcomes, they don't need a conversation, they need results and programs and partnership to deliver nation-to-nation responses that solve some of the age-old challenges that are being faced. So immediately, one of the first things we did as a parliament was pass the new Canada Child Benefit, which directly impacts and in some ways you can look at it as the first step towards basic income, directly impacts the situation facing particularly low-income families with kids, most of whom are single-parent families, most of whom led by women. The CCB, as we call it, immediately lifted 300,000 children out of poverty. That was our first act as a government. This represents about a 40% reduction in child poverty rates across this country, and that was done as part of the fulfillment of a major campaign platform, but it also starts to show when we talk about gender parity in our cabinet, it's not just about making sure that there are women in the seats around the table, it's also making sure that the impacts of our programs are felt in a way that can be measured as reducing the inequality that many women face. And when you think about it at its root, poverty is one of those profoundly sexist things we deal with in the society. The second thing we did was we increased the guaranteed income supplement for seniors. In particular, this was focused on single seniors. If you've been a couple for a long time and a partner dies, quite often pension and pension benefits pass with that member's end of life. And that plunges the person left alone, again, based on percentages, quite often women, it plunges them straight into poverty. And so we boosted that by 10% for singles in particular, because we're looking to target particular groups with particular policies as we move towards an all-government approach to dealing with this terrible, terrible plight of poverty in our society. Fundamentally for me, come as no surprise if you heard me speak before, the foundation to building a stronger life for any Canadian, the foundation for transforming poverty outcomes and eradication of poverty challenges, if you want to deal with mental health, if you want to deal with an issue that confronts any part of the poverty spectrum, you have got to have a place to do that. That's called home. It's not a shelter, it's a home. And so our government stepped up immediately in housing. Budget last year in 2016. There have been some criticisms this year. There's no money in this year's budget for this year. That's because it was put in last year, so the governments, in particular municipalities, had a bit of a runway. And so the housing, the homelessness partnership strategy was increased by 100%. We doubled the money that went to provinces and through that to municipalities and housing providers. That money is being spent this year and last year as we move towards what I think is the most transformational part of the budget that we put down just about 3 weeks ago, which is the promise, the commitment, and the delivery of a national housing strategy for the first time in this country's history. The centerpiece of that is an $11 billion investment that starts to roll in over the next 10 years. Some of the dollar amounts and the specifics around this, we have to kind of hold back because we're in a negotiating position right now with the provinces. We want to leverage as much of that money through provincial capitals so that we multiply the impacts, multiply the dollars that are possible with matching funds. We also want to lock it in for 10 years. There's been criticism that 80% of the money comes in the last 8 years of the program. 80% of the money comes in the first 8 years of the program, 30% in the first 3 years, 30% in the last 3 years. It's equal installments over your 10 years, 10% a year, so you're going to get money in the last year is equal to the money in the first year. What is important about this is not to get locked down in discussion of front-end loading, back-end loading, is to remember a couple of things. When we doubled the funding base, we created about a $4.8 billion funding base. That carries forward into this program. And when that starts to expire, as operating agreements expire, the new money starts to come on, so the $11.2 billion gets added to the $4.8 billion, which means over the next 10 years, we have actually $16 billion of funding committed from the federal government into housing, but it doesn't end there. There's also a loans program. There's also Aboriginal off-reserve housing. There's also in the health accords, and this is one of the unsung accomplishments of the government. Jane Philpott, the Minister of Health, put in the housing, in the health accord, which was the top up to the 3% increase to basic funding from the federal government to the provinces for healthcare. She put in the $11 billion top up, services for home care, palliative care, services for addiction treatment, and services for mental health treatment. All of them have housing programming dollars attached to them and are requirements of the provinces to step up on those fronts, which means that supportive housing now has both the $16 billion in capital available to it, but it also has part of the $11 billion, and it depends on our province-to-province basis, $11 billion in programming support. So this notion of supportive housing now becomes the possibility as programming dollars delivered by healthcare professionals and housing by housing providers can now touch on the ground and create real opportunities to create the kind of housing we know is fundamental to tackling these issues. The other component of the health accord and the housing accord, which I think is critical for this conversation, is that the health accord mental health dollars are targeted at eliminating wait times for youth under the age of 24 in this country. Think about that. You're going to eliminate wait times for young people. If you're a middle class, sort of family with professional credentials and access to the services, it can take 9 or 10 months. John Oliver, who's a member of caucus from Oakville, is a former ran a hospital in Oakville. When his family needed mental health services for one of their kids, it took him 9 months to find services. He speaks English. He presents as a white Canadian. He has affluence and well-connected networks into the mental health services. If he can't find services, start thinking about the challenges faced by racialized communities. Culturally specific communities that require different forms of treatment in order to find their health. Think about people without English as a first language. Think about a single mom who's barely getting to work on transit, who now has to go find a doctor and get their kid to treatment. If we don't focus in on eliminating wait times for young people, we know that the chronic implications and the medical diagnostics that come downstream are even more difficult to deal with. So for the first time in this country's history, we're focusing in on eliminating the barriers to mental health treatment for a whole generation of young people. And the best part about this is that as you build that system out, and you build that system across the country, and you think about rural and northern communities, and you think about the coastal communities, and you think about indigenous communities, both on and off reserve, as you build a stronger mental health system, it's not about flying kids from Attawa down into the south to get treatment. It's about building a system into those communities to get the treatment on the ground and in place. And that, I think, is a fundamental investment. Add to that $7 billion in investing in the early childhood learning and daycare framework, which starts next year, because last year we put $500 million into it for this year, so it's really $7.5 billion over 11 years. Add to that the fact that we are now engaged in poverty reduction strategy as a framework, as new measurement tools, and what you see is an all-government approach to tackling poverty that's focused on housing, mental health and healthcare issues, Indigenous reconciliation in partnership with our Indigenous communities. But fundamentally what's happening is that we're investing into people's lives so that people can solve the problems themselves. We are here to work with you. We are here to create the strategy with you. We are listening in particular not only to the professionals and the caregivers in this situation, and as you can see from the panel today, the lived experience, which is the final piece of this puzzle. For far too long, strategies have been top-down and have not been experience-driven. And we know that the people who face the day-to-day struggles of acquiring services, of sustaining life, of making sure that they move forward in their communities and provide leadership in their communities and untap that leadership, we know that if we don't have lived experience at the table when we talk about this, we are not going to change the experience of those who are living with poverty. We can do it. And I'll leave you with one last note. I was had a great privilege to represent this country at Habitat 3 in Quito, Ecuador. Habitat 3 is the only UN conference secretariat that deals with urbanism and housing. housing and settlement. It's the only UN permanent secretariat that has lived experience as part of its mandate and at the actual convention. We have Slum Dwellers International presenting to government ministers. You have folks that from South Africa, from the women's markets of South Africa, talking about local economic development to ministers of finance as well as the UN delegations. And there was one clear thing that came out of that set of meetings. Poverty is the single most vicious, persistent, lethal, multinational dynamic in the world in terms of crime. It's a crime, what happens. It is dangerous. We know it shortens lives. We know what it does to women. We know what it does to displaced refugee communities. We know what it does to indigenous populations. We know what it does even to those who think of themselves as affluent. There has never been a country that has made it illegal. And yet it is the fundamental problem and the fundamental violence that people deal with in their lives day in and day out. We have an opportunity with these 10-year accords on health, on housing, on the anti-poverty restriction. We have an opportunity in this country to be the first country to move towards eliminating that form of violence in our communities. We will not do it alone. We can't do it just at the federal level. We need our municipal partners, our indigenous partners. We need social agencies, the women's movement. We need all of the groups together to make this the priority that we tackle as a transformative agenda for this country as we move into this new century. We're poised to get it done. The money's on the table. Let's spend it.
So thank you very much, Parliamentary Secretary. You know, when many of us think of poverty, we think almost exclusively about income. You know, here in Hamilton, we dealt a little bit with outcomes. I was interested to hear the minister in his video say that they want to have a data and evidence-based solution to this. You know, here in Hamilton, we did a project called Code Red, and we looked at some of those outcomes. We saw that there was a 21-year difference in life expectancy between the best and the worst neighborhoods in Hamilton. We saw health outcomes where the differences between the top and the bottom were not just double or triple, but 10, 20, 30 times difference from top to bottom. So we're seeing that there's lots of things besides income and the effects that those things have. We just did a project a few days ago that you may have seen that looked at something as simple as fires. Fires are more prevalent in lower income neighborhoods, deaths from fires, injuries from fires. So it's so pervasive everywhere. You know, poverty is linked to not just income, but things like education, your family life, your access to services, your mental, your physical health. So to the three wonderful women that we have here, Hilary, Penni, Yvonne, could you please, you know, maybe talk to the Parliamentary Secretary and explain the meaning of poverty to this government, which is now in the midst of trying to develop an anti-poverty plan. So perhaps you could all take a turn sharing your observations.
Thank you for being here. I saw Mr. Vaughan speak at the Canadian Alliance to End Homelessness in London. You were a rock star. Love what you host. So, we're talking here about lived experience. Now, I'm still living in poverty, but I'm not homeless. And I'm very fortunate. But some of the things that I've experienced is not being able to get a job because I can't afford to get a degree. And I can't afford to get a degree because of my age. My credit was bad, so who's going to give me credit for a degree? So one of the things we'd like to get in this strategy of my colleagues is talking about how we can make part of the economy better with our lived experience by earning a decent wage, right? So one of the things that we've been talking about in discussions, and it's a conversation ongoing in Calgary, is not just basic income, not just living wage, but we want to be part of the community. But how can we do that when we don't have social work status, an economic degree, we're not a lawyer? Things happen along the way to us through our journey. So, Mr. Vaughan, I'd like to ask you, is there a way we can solve that problem? I want to be hired because of my expertise, but I don't need a degree at 57 years old to do it. I have the expertise.
So, I often tell stories rather than talk policy, but there isn't policy to help you. I found this one in the last budget. I'll give you a bit of a confession. One of the most important mentors in my life was Jane Jacobs, world-renowned urbanist, brilliant author. Her books are taught, I think, and translated in more than 100 different languages and taught in universities around the world. She didn't go to university. She had a huge problem with credentialism and the notion that somehow acquiring a few initials after the end of your name suddenly makes you an expert. And her belief was that the lived experience was actually a much better teacher. And I think this is also something present within many of our Aboriginal communities in terms of the learning experience of young people in the North. They learn by doing much more than they learn by being taught. And so transforming our educational process to accommodate this, I think, is fundamentally important. So here's the confession. I'm a high school dropout. I don't often talk about that because it keeps you out of cabinet sometimes. But the reality is that I didn't go to university to learn what I had to learn. I immersed myself in the experiences of what was available to me in Toronto to learn about my city and how to live and be a citizen in my city. And so I understand exactly what you're talking about, because when you get to the point where you're a journalist and you don't have a degree, or when you get to caucus and everyone around you is a doctor, a lawyer, or an academic with great credentials, you kind of feel like you're not supposed to be there. You kind of feel like your ideas, while they may be fully evolved and well-researched and well-read, they haven't been recognized by someone who recognizes you. And you feel kind of inhibited by that. So, when I first got there, somebody said, you should go off and do one of those quick summer courses at Harvard and get a certificate in public administration and just say you went to Harvard and no one will check. Doesn't work that way. They do check. I also thought that no. First of all, the House of Commons is the House of the Commons, and you need those perspectives at the table. And there are people with those life experiences around the table when you start to push into it. But the reality is that to translate your lived experience into a commodity that you can then trade in the market to acquire the resources you need to support yourself, that unfortunately is the system that most of us operate in, and we need to figure that out. So in this budget, EI, which we're in the process of also reviewing and looking at making significant changes to, but before we get there, before we change things that mess up the actuarial tables and change the rates that people pay and how it's folded into paychecks and all that sort of stuff. There's stuff that we're trying to do to manipulate it, to modify it, so that, for example, if you were on, if you had a job right now working, sort of in one of those tough wage service sector jobs, and you acquired enough capacity to get on the EI, and you wanted to go to a community college or university or take a certificate, right now you get punished by having that EI pulled back. We're leaving that EI on the table so that you can actually pursue upgrades and training while you're receiving that. That's why the other thing that is starting to happen, and I think that this is where, I'm not going to get partisan about this, but the move that Kathleen Wynne just made to make tuition free for people earning less than $90,000 a year is another extraordinary step in the revolution that is underway in the education system in Ontario, which is quite extraordinary. When Itty takes over, the dropout, the completion rate in Ontario was 65% of high school students finished high school. It's now 85%, which is why as they went from all-day learning to reduce class sizes, the investments they've made on an upgraded generational spot have led us to the point where they're now tackling the high cost of post-secondary so that people can get into the job market much more easily. And in particular, for people returning to school, that creates a real opportunity as well. So there's a number of steps that are being taken. And then I can't without acknowledging the challenge that First Nations communities have with distance learning and the lack of resources. That's the other
issue that now has to be tackled, and there's movement on that to get more kids into university, into training, into trades. We have to focus on that, because in this economy, if you don't have the ability to learn as you work and work as you learn, you're just not going to get ahead. So we're focused on that. It's part of the anti-poverty strategy. It's part of the early steps we've taken towards a more just society, and hopefully it'll start to get you to a spot where you can wear those black gowns and look down at me for not having a degree. Penni?
Hi, everybody. My name is Penni Eisenhaur, and I just want everybody to know this is the first time I've ever been sort of positioned up on a stage like this, so I'm very lucky. Dictionary, and I just want to read what it actually says online. It says, the state of being extremely poor, the state of being inferior in quality or insufficient in amounts. That's pretty hopeless, I thought. But I also thought that my definition of poverty I'm just going to say it the way I feel, it's a disempowering systemic process that is unnavigatable. It's created to set individuals up to fail. But I would like to just kind of extend a little bit on failure, because failure can be viewed as very complex barriers that government need to understand more clearly. And the removal of barriers take like years. And so for myself and many people that I work with, one of the barriers to access many things, including employment, including education, including even volunteering in their children's school, is the criminal record and the process around the criminal record. Since the government has come into place, it's still a very arduous process to get through, and it's very costly for individuals. And so I would like the government to take another look at that and the process around the criminal record. And the criminal record is not, you're not pardoned anymore. It's a record suspension, and you pay a lot of money. And I actually looked at the paperwork, because I have personal experience with the justice system, and I'm a pretty intelligent woman, and I've got some education. And the paperwork was so overwhelming that I basically just put it aside. And I've been eligible since 2016 of November to apply for one, but I don't want to apply for a record suspension, because a record suspension basically, your information remains in a database. You're basically held hostage. If you reoffend, it comes back. And I'm not saying to pardon all crimes. I'm talking about poverty-related crimes that are barriers to people to try to move forward in their lives.
Thank you. And a couple of thoughts on that. It was made tougher in the last 10 years as well, and that's where the notion of a suspension as opposed to a cleansing of the record is there. We also know that the criminal justice system works differently in different sections of society. We know that women are convicted far more often for crimes of supporting themselves as opposed to taking from other people or impacting dynamics outside their existence. And so it's certainly, quite often women find themselves ensnared in the justice system because they're trying to survive and get pushed even further back in their efforts to move forward based on the fact that their behavior is criminalized, and it's largely a result of responding to poverty, which is, from my perspective, the bigger crime. So that's one situation. We also know that the racialized communities, and we don't need to go into the hard statistics of First Nations and Métis Nation and Inuit communities, but the rate of incarceration is phenomenal. In the African-Canadian community, the black community, we know that they've worked very hard as social activists to get mental health officers into the court system, because most crime that, that presents itself, especially with young people, is really a social dysfunction rather than criminal behavior, although some is serious. One of the things we know is that when they achieved that remarkable recognition and got the program launched, Ontario, almost 15 years ago, started hiring mental health caseworkers in the court system. Not a single African-Canadian social worker or mental health professional was hired. And so the community that fought and accomplished it was left on the sidelines once again. So we have significant reforms to make in the criminal justice system that have to move it from a sort of a focus on crime and punishment into a healing and rehabilitation system. And part of that requires us to review sentences, the mandatory minimum sentences. They sound great. In some crimes they probably are needed, but across the board, the way they've been instituted have not reduced crime, they simply increased rates of incarceration. That's got to change. That review is underway with Minister Raybould Wilson leading that charge. The second thing we need to do is we need to think about exit strategies for institutional care. You know, there's a family in my riding whose son went off his meds, is dealing with a multiple series of challenges. The only way to get him into hospital into care was to call the police. When the police came, he was assaulted, his mother was assaulted, the apartment was ransacked, it's a public housing unit, it still hasn't been fixed. There are real systemic challenges to the way in which we use the criminal justice system to solve social dynamics, which really should be an anti-poverty response, not a criminal response. And that comes down to even things like the addiction issue, which is dealt with as a criminal issue, it's a health issue. And so changing those approaches is fundamental. It needs to be part of the way we view an anti-poverty strategy. But as I said, our government isn't waiting for those lessons to be learned. We're acting on those fronts already.
So I just want to mention that there is a network of us in St. John that have been working with MP Wayne Long on this. However, it's really slow. And so I'm just wondering, when you go back, if you could like maybe put a push on that.
The most horrific thing about when I went through those numbers, but however, it's after the next election. Yeah, because we're halfway through our mandate, and I figured I just got reelected, you know, yesterday. It is painfully slow. It's when I was first elected, John Sewell, the former mayor of Toronto, said to me, "Adam, your job is not to represent the bureaucracy to the public, but the public to the bureaucracy." And I have a going away party for a city planner when I was a city councillor. Somebody said it took Kyle Ray was there as another city councillor. Said it took Kyle Ray 6 years to understand that the staff is wrong. It took Adam 6 weeks. Impatience is important, and your impatience. One of the things that Constituency Weeks does, and one of the reasons lived experience is so important, is that if that sense of urgency is not constantly pushed in front of politicians, we don't get complacent. But we're working with a massive bureaucracy that does things very slowly, very carefully. Their job is not to make mistakes. Our job is to try and break rules and try and push those ideas through. If we don't find a way, and this is part of the debate having in Parliament right now, we can only get so much legislation through 338 members at a time. If we don't find a way to quicken our response in real time, the solutions you need in real time don't materialize, and that's a challenge. So you have my word that I will be as impatient, and I expect you to. This is your life. You should follow up on it. And my job is to make sure that you don't have to follow up on it, but instead you have programs that solve the problem. But impatience is really important, and telling people to move faster is really important. But I'm going to give you one caution with that. As a politician, you have got to let politicians make mistakes again. This notion of punishing every misstep, it's part of what paralyzes us from making mistakes. We're afraid to spend into a new program because if there's a boondoggle and the newspaper gets a hold of it and says, look at that, there's a, you know, somebody went, I mean, the firing of Derek Ballantyne from Toronto Community Housing because he bought chocolates at a Christmas party for his staff, he got fired for that. This is a guy that Obama tried to recruit to run HUD. And he got chased out of Toronto because he gave boxes of chocolates to frontline workers at Toronto Community Housing. Because the Toronto Sun Times. That's nuts. That's so petty, it's nuts. But what's worse is that things like, and we have a program in Toronto right now that's high-risk youth, not at-risk youth, high-risk youth, kids who have been in custody, who have done some pretty silly things. They're being trained to switch toilets in Toronto Community Housing neighborhoods, to take the high-volume water toilets, take them out and put in better toilets, new ones, but are also low water, so they save money, they're good conservation, you know, water takes a lot of electricity. They're being trained. The union is opposing them coming in on a community, so it's a community social development model. It's being financed with a whole series of wonderful mechanisms. The union's stopping them from coming because they're saying it's union work. There's no funding model to get rid of these toilets. There is a huge advantage getting these kids trained and the trades ready to work. And yet we've got social justice advocates doing one thing, we've got the unions doing another thing, we've got the city government stepping back saying, I'm not going to get involved. And instead of delivering a solution, we're all covering our asses and protecting our turf. And so we need to be able to say, look, we're going to bring this in. Yeah, it opens the door to private companies delivering public services, and yeah, where do you get your money from, and dot, 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 and well, how much are you paying the kids, and how much is a good union job worth, and all those sorts of things. But if we're not prepared to experiment and learn how that model works, and we're not prepared to see a failure on that front, we're not going to get the new toilets, we're not going to get kids employed, and we're not going to fix public housing. But what? So you've got to let us try stuff, fail, learn, and try again. That requires a political constituency around failure, as opposed to just focused on success.
Thank you. Thanks, Yvonne. Hello. Yvonne.
Okay, my turn. It's kind of, I'm going to get emotional up here now listening to everything. I know I've been pretty strong the last couple of days in the words I say, so. But one of the commonalities that I hear throughout, and I'd like to thank Tamarack actually, very much so for allowing me the opportunity, allowing us the opportunity to come up here and say our piece too. I know 2 years ago I actually had a very bad experience at Tamarack, and it had to do with, I was invited on a panel, and the fact that it was a variety of things, we're talking about many things, so it's like we had, you know, there was the gay, lesbians, and then we had, you know, who was the other group? All the different groups, you know, all the special groups, right? And, okay, well, everybody's special. All the special groups. But we were included in that group, too. And but the thing was I expressed at that time, it's like mixing apples, oranges, and bananas together, right? We all got issues that relate. We all have important issues that we want to bring forward. But what happened at that time was I really felt left out. As the Aboriginal person, and I didn't see very many Aboriginal people at that particular meeting either. So it really bothered me. And actually, I ended up leaving that meeting crying. And I went home very upset. And my husband was like, you know, what happened to you? And I said, it is so hard to do this work. It's so hard. Because not only do I live it, right? I can't just take the coat off and say I'm no longer an Aboriginal person, right? So it's a very hard thing. And one of the common things that I have heard in the last couple days in the work, and I have to applaud everybody, is the sense of how much you have realized the importance of having to work and deal with the Indigenous people. Because when you look at poverty, you know, in fact, if you look at homelessness and poverty, which are rightly connected, Aboriginal people have been homeless for over 500 years. Okay? This is our country. And yet, when you take a look at those numbers, and I've seen this is the thing I've seen, they're finally recognizing how much our people, my people, are represented in those numbers. I know I said in my workshop the other day, I says, even just for Ontario, I think as I'm living in poverty, Aboriginal people are about 78% in this southern area. 78% live in poverty. You know, if you, as you go north, you can face up to 100% on some reserves. I say third world countries are our reserves, right? There's a lot of infrastructure that still has to be developed. And so when I look at the numbers, and when we look at these numbers, and I know overall, it's my people, Aboriginal people, Indigenous people, that are highly represented across the board, okay? We are the highest when it comes to incarceration. In fact, and I hate to say, a lot of our spirituality that our people are able to access is usually incarceration. That's when they first learn about their own spirituality. They learn about their own culture and how to heal themselves. It's pretty sad that you gotta go to jail to learn that stuff. I have also sit on the City of Hamilton Aboriginal Advisory Committee here in Hamilton. I've sat on there for a number of years. I'm not on it right now. But what I tried to bring to the forefront to say was, the cities aren't made for Indians. They haven't been made for Indians for a long time. We're only coming to a point, and like again, a sense of the truth and reconciliation, that I've seen positive change. I have been an advocate all my life from when I think I was like 18, 19 years old when I first got on the board. Actually, I got on the board of directors for the Hamilton Regional Indian Center. So growing up very poor, growing up running from others because I was beaten on a fairly daily basis from other kids and picked on, I learned to fight. And once I learned to fight, even though I'm as a little person as I am, I'm pretty vocal. And in my community, I have quite a reputation that I have developed, and it's just because I do speak up about Aboriginal issues. I have been on various boards throughout my lifetime, as well as being involved in my community. So I know a lot of these things that we talk about, actually, my people are very much a part of. And again, I have been very proud to hear, like even though when we had the lady who came in to talk about human rights, and how she kept going on about the Indigenous people, and how we have to make change. We have to start learning about the history. And that's so important too, because unfortunately, and this is Canada's shame, they do not represent the true Aboriginal history in Canada. Because people, I've actually been asked at points, what's wrong with your people, right? And I look at them, and it's actually, I've had to take sensitivity training myself to be able to respond to these questions. And I will say, so I've been trying to calm down, because first remark, I always like to say, but what I say is, before I can tell you what's wrong with my people, you need to know my history. When you know my history, then you know what's wrong with my people, right? And that is so true, because the history of the Aboriginal Indigenous people of Canada has not been truly told, right? So in the effects in regards to residential school, I am a product of residential school. My father was in residential school. So in that sense, I learned many negative things about being a Native person. Growing up, I learned many negative things growing up as a child, not to be proud as a Native person, right? So that's what made me become a fighter. Going through school though, I was so quiet, I didn't say boo. We like to hide, we don't want to be noticed. But as time went on, and I think the age of 12, I had an epiphany, they say, or whatever, when I started to realize what's wrong. What's wrong with us? But then it took me another probably 10 years to realize it's not us, it's them, right? And that's the way we look at things. Because even though we're within our own country, we are still separate from everybody else because we are different. And so what my suggestions would be is it's about time that we're going into the direction we are. In our communities before pre-contract, the way things were explained was in a village, we're a community, okay? All of us are in a community, and in that community, there was no hierarchy. There was no who's the rich and who's the poor. In our communities, it basically was, we either had a good season and everybody ate well, right? Even those who didn't have food, others would make sure and hunt for them to make sure they had the food to survive that winter. Or it was a really bad year and everybody suffered. It wasn't one or the other. There was no hierarchy of who's rich and who has more and who doesn't. We had so many things, structures in place that in heart, we are going back to, in a way, because it's about the people. And that's one of the things that I feel that has been lost within Canada. And this is a rich country. There is no need to have, even I know for those who've seen that video yesterday, that was my first time seeing that video for the roundtable poverty. And I had the opportunity to say the last words in it. And those words were basically, everybody deserves, it's a human right, to have a roof over their head, to have food in their belly. And again, Canada is a rich country. There is no need to have this, you know, where the rich is rich and the poor is poor. Like you think about it. Personally, when they release that Sunshine Report and they talk about the money and how many thousands and millions of dollars that people are making. Personally, I think they should be ashamed of themselves. Unless you can touch a person and heal them of all their illnesses, you don't deserve that kind of money, right? That's the way I look at it. If they were to share that money and spread it out, government needs to put caps on things. I'm sorry, when we got people who can't pay a hydro bill, and you find out the guy, the head honchos at hydro, are making a top dollar, like over millions of dollars, there's something wrong with that. Big time. There are so many things across the system that need to be fixed. And I understand there's people with good hearts that try to do good work. And I hate to say, we get beaten down. We get beaten down a lot. I know it within my own community. I feel many a times beaten down because you're trying to look for help. And the thing is, when you start talking about Native issues, I find that people, you know, we have better hearts now, but I'd say 10 years ago, as soon as I'd start talking about the Indian issues, Native issues, the eyes would start going up like this, start going down like that, and I could just feel, oh, that's not my problem. I didn't do that to them. I didn't do that to your people. You know, stuff like that. And I understand that. This is a shameful thing that has happened to the Indigenous people of Canada. And unfortunately, because of what has happened through resident reserves and residential school in our history, we are at a point where we are the highest represented in poverty. So when you look at those numbers, our people are there. So we need to be in a position where we can start to make change, being a part of the conversation. And that's one of the things I have to admit, being part of the roundtable. It was a little rough in the beginning to start, but I feel like in the last couple of years, my words are actually being heard. I brought the Spectator. I was so happy to read the Spectator in the sense that we had the mayor who was here yesterday, and same with the other gentleman, Howard, and their articles. There's two points that they made specifically to the fact that we have to start looking at Indigenous people, right? This is a common thread that I hear over and over again. So the plan to recognize that early investment in children and families has the greatest impact on education, employment, and health outcomes for two generations to escape poverty. It further acknowledges the need for Indigenous-led poverty reduction. Indigenous people in Canada and Hamilton face multiple barriers that lead to higher rates of poverty, illness, and homelessness. Hell, I haven't seen this kind of words like this in a long time. So, for me, this conference has been a little bit. Because I had, like I said, 2 years ago, I left crying. I'm here today, I'm crying, but tears are not happy, because it's about damn time that people are hearing. And the government itself is at a time. It starts to need to be listening to its Aboriginal people. And it also needs to be listening to the grassroots people. All the answers aren't up here. Even in the Indigenous community, it's not all up there. Sometimes you gotta get dirty, get down in the dirt and find out what's really going on. Thank you.
Folks often talk about it's human nature. It's, you take what you need, you take what you have to do, and
and dot dot dot. And that has, you know, there's a duality to our species that we need to come to terms with. I know in a lot of indigenous teachings and talking with elders, it's the reconciliation between your head and your heart, thinking the right things but feeling the right things simultaneously. And when they're not connected, don't move. Wait until they feel connected, then start to act into your life and act into your community. But in the colonial culture, in the settler culture, I have never been at a dinner where, you know, someone's been cooking all day and done the shopping and prepped up a meal and has the table set for five, and there's a knock at the door and somebody's grandmother or a neighbor shows up or somebody just comes by sort of unexpectedly, if you're home, want to go out. I have never seen four meals cooked when a fifth person shows up and sharing doesn't happen naturally. It's one of our great capacities as humans is to actually trust each other and divide the pie differently or cook a bigger pie if necessary. And that's effectively what the anti-poverty structure is about. It's about returning our values instead of I'm okay, you know, and this sort of rugged individualist. And it's part of the concern I have when people start talking about individual rights or human rights as the pursuit of individual practice or individual acquisition of needs. There are also community responsibilities that are balanced with individual rights that need to be folded into this conversation, because it's not enough just to be able to say, I got my house, you go fight for your rights, it's protected under the law, go hire a lawyer, you'll be fine. We've got to come to a different model of not accessing services through rights, but creating services through the recognition that's how we realize human rights. Lenny Fari, who's the UN Rapporteur on Housing, when confronting the issue of should housing be a right, in a conversation, I can't remember which one of us said it, we said, you know, housing as a right doesn't necessarily give you the right housing. You know, I can find you a house in a coastal community with no job. I could put you in the house and give you a set of keys and put a roof over your head, but if you're not connected to a community that is embracing of your rights, you've simply been housed. And we have to house people, not just build housing. So there's a series of lessons we have to sort of deconstruct and learn and bring into harmony. And one of them is creating stronger communities. An elder I talked to, a Cree elder from Alberta, near just north of Edmonton, talked about stop talking about building housing and start talking about building community. Stop talking about healing me and start healing my community. Stop talking about the individual and start talking about the community. And that's part of what we have to do as a government, is get back to that. And that's part of the wisdom that the elders in right across the country, from nation to nation, if there's some common touchstones you start to hear, that's one of the most fundamental ones, is build that community, don't just build individual rights.
That just to add to that, is definitely our philosophy. It's because in the house, it's not just a house. Everything else, we need all those other supports within that house, right? They all, you know, to really to be, we look at the medicine wheel, you know, the physical, mental, spiritual, and there's one more there, it's skipping my mind. But with those four things, it's like we need all of those things to be good human beings, to be caring and sharing and things like that. So when government does decide, or when all these monies are going to flow, we can't just do the brick and mortar. There has to be supports that come along with it. And I hate to say, I know with my people along, and what I hear in general, mental illness is out there where there needs to be a lot more supports for people in those situations, right? Because they're like in a boat floating in the sea. You know, there's nowhere to go and nowhere to help them. So, unfortunately, with my people, FASD runs rampant, okay? So that's where the mental illness may come in. And so we have dysfunction, a lot of dysfunction in that sense. But again, it's tied to the history of what has happened. But when you decide to start building all these good things that I'm hearing, remember, there has to be supports that go along with them. They have to go hand in hand, you know? So you got your roof over your head, but you still need food, you still need hydro, you still need telephone, you still need furniture and water, okay? Thank you.
And to that point, the funding levels are woefully inadequate within First Nations, Métis Nation, and Inuit communities. We know that, and the statistics, you know, bear it out. It doesn't require statistics to understand it, but it's there. there's been a great push to say just, you know, ramp up the spending as a way of measuring outcome or measuring input. And it's quite frankly scary. I was in Manitoba last week, and I was talking specifically with Métis Nation. I was recalling a conversation with an elder who runs a daycare program at the Lord Selkirk Housing Program, which is, if you want to see where integrated community service models are transformative, one of the most dangerous neighborhoods in Canada, the highest homicide rates, the highest assault rates, highest rates of eviction, the highest rates of all the things that you, in your work, you identified that there's multiple. When you map out all the crises, they all seem to land in the same postal code. This community revitalized the housing project by building a daycare center that took care of the parents. It's a fascinating system. What they did is they take the kids into care with the grandmothers and the elders, and they give them, you know, the teachings and the food, and they, you know, that they get to play all day in a safe, wonderful environment. But the real work that the community does, that's a sort of employment program for elders in the community. The real work that the people with training do is go back into the houses where the kids have now been taken out, and they fix the problems in the household that need to be fixed as a form of child care. So that they get you your identification, they hook you up with the right. The child care benefit doesn't touch the Indigenous community because many people on reserve in particular, but many First Nations people don't think they have to pay taxes, their treaty right. So they don't register with the Canadian Revenue Agency, so they don't receive the child benefit. I get it. It's you don't need to pay taxes necessarily to receive benefits, but a program that gets people just filing their taxes on reserve would deliver the child benefit, which is huge. It's a lot of money, right? It's transformative amount of income, would get that into communities. We have to figure out how to build the trust that when we bring you into a government service and register you, which has all kinds of colonial history and implication, that sometimes it's the way in which our system can touch you. And we need to figure that piece of the programming out. But getting back to Lord Selkirk and this notion of healing the community, it's you know, this notion of just pumping money in. The system in Manitoba, which has been run by a very progressive government for the last 10 years, has the highest rate of child apprehension. It's higher than the Scoop 60 rates. It's higher than residential. So we are putting more kids into care in Manitoba than any other province in the country. And if we were to suddenly shove tons more money into that system, you just see tons more kids ripped from their culture and pulled out of their homes. So, you know, money is part of the solution. That's why I'm up in Ottawa. My job is to find the money and pump it into the system. But the system has to be transformed as well. And that's why the lived experience conversation is so critical, is if we don't change the system, simply funding more of it is going to create the same distortions that we've seen in the past. So learning from those experiences, learning from how the First Nations community has transformed that neighborhood, learning from how elders approach community rather than the individual and heal the individual by healing the community, realizing that there's a network that's created the problems and a network that's been solved. That's the learning experience that's coming across the government. And this gets back to this issue of patience and impatience. We can't change all that quickly, and if we did, we would have an impact on people that might be catastrophic. But we, at the same time, we can't move slow, we can't move too fast either. Finding that sweet spot is going to be critically important. And it comes down to listening to, as you've presented today, individual small things you can do that just together start to make all those changes. So gradually changing EI to include training lifelong learning, gradually making the system for cleansing your record and getting it off the books so that you feel free to do what you need to do, is part of the lessons that have been delivered here this morning, is that when you do all those little things to heal all the different components of the community, it's not poverty that disappears, it's people's lives that emerge. And that's the goal of the government.
Thank you. Well, we're almost out of time, so I think maybe the best thing for us to do is for each of the three panelists here, why don't you just take a minute and just give us some final thoughts on you know, where you'd like to see things go and maybe just your final thoughts on the issue.
Just cut it from the heart, right?
Knock yourself out.
That's what I do.
That was a figure of speech. Don't do that literally.
No, I need a coffee after this one. Let me tell you. Okay. So what I would like to say to you and your clinics is one of the things we've done recently in Calgary that has been transformative for vulnerable people. Is our provincial government gave City of Calgary $13.5 million for a 3-year affordable transportation project. We had the fair fares in Calgary for a $44 a month low income bus pass, but now with work with people like me and my colleagues, we've got that down to a sliding scale now based on income with very few proxies. And that has been transformative. I'd like to see that system go all across Canada. Our Mayor Nenji, even said that was the biggest thing Calgary City Council could have done for poverty reduction. And it's effective. We just started this month, but we're planning on doing a study in 6 months to see how effective that was. Because without transportation, you can't get anywhere, take your kids to daycare, get food, anything, right? So I just want to let you know this is something that I think maybe in the poverty reduction strategy could be a thought of consideration and discussion. Because I know in Calgary, it has been a movement for change, seriously.
So I'd just like to say that St. John has been identified as one of the 6 communities that will be part of the poverty reduction strategy. And I would just like to say that, you know, case studies are case studies. And I think that St. John is in a position where we are aligned very well, and we have many partners that are committed to this endeavor in St. John. And we have measurable outcomes, we have evaluations, but what we don't have are the resources in order for us to be able to scale things up instead of keep things like as they are. And so when the government is looking at testing new innovative ideas, St. John have already tested a lot of really awesome innovative ideas around all the issues that we've been talking about, and what we need are the resources to take them to the next level. And I would like the government to really think about that when you're looking at allocating resources. Because you did speak about measured outcomes and data, and I believe like you have to be driven in that direction in some areas, and I would like you to look at that. And then the other thing I wanted to say is around, I'm very grateful around the child tax credit and the new initiative around that, but the voices that I hear from in St. John, and I'd like you to think about this, is its relationship to food security around the date that the child tax credit is sent out. It's the 20th of the month, and a lot of the people that I talk to, they would like to see it at the 15th of the month, because 21 days or 20 days until you, the next time you get your pay, your money, is a very long time, and I'd like people around here to think about that, because that is a long time even for myself. The food banks are overly inundated with a volume that they most of the times can't handle, and I believe that the two are almost associated. And I think that if you it's a very easy, quick solution. It's just a change in the date, and processing and administration can be quickly done on that one. And I would like to see you do that nationally and study it for a year and link it to food security and all the other things, and see if that does make a difference. Because I know that the people that I talk to, they would really appreciate that.
I guess for myself, my suggestion would be we need to make less barriers. Because I know when my friend here spoke about being incarcerated and how you're penalized and how that carries with you throughout your life. So you can imagine how many Aboriginal people are limited then to doing anything, right? Because I hate to say, growing up we do a lot of crazy things at times, and that record carries with you, right? I have 2 fine brothers that were examples of that. But, you know, when you're trying to move on and move up, you know, you might have done something when you're 20 and now you're 30 or 40 and you've got a good head on your shoulders, but that's held against you. I just, again, to remove the barriers, right? And one of the things, as this is the hard part, even in the work I do, because, you know, on one hand we're told you're supposed to think with this, you do all your work with this, but Native way, we do this. We are guided by this, right? And so, because we were taught that spirit, when Creator created us, He put a little bit of His spirit in our hearts so that He's always there. So in that sense, it's like, we can't always go into everything just using this. We have to use this. This is the part that connects us to each other. This is the humanity part. So I commend the work that I have seen. At least with the truth and reconciliation, at least it's being spoke about. You know, when they did the Royal Proclamation in the, I don't know how many, that was 92 or something. That's just a report collecting dust, right? So, and you were right about one thing. We were talking about, okay, we don't pay taxes. Again, if you know our history, you know why we were taught. We were never supposed to pay taxes. We were not a conquered people of this land, right? When the foreigners, we would call them visitors, came over, we actually have a wampum belt, two-row wampum belt. It has two sides. You walk your path, we'll walk our path, not to cross, right? When people started coming to Canada, coming up here, that was basically the treaty at that time, right? Well, look where we sit now. Those paths crossed, and we're at the bottom. So, I'm happy to hear that things are going back, and I admire the fact that you've been speaking with elders. I'm really happy to hear that, to hear what they're telling you, because this is our way, and we really need to be a part of the process. Right? Because if we are the biggest numbers of the problem, we definitely have ideas of how to fix it. But we have to be included in that conversation, which has happened. And again, I'm happy to see some changes moving forward. But when it comes to Indigenous people, there's a long history of various things that are wrong. Right? So that's not going to get fixed overnight, I know that. But there's a lot of things there that we have to take from in order to make things better. Right? So I would say, just to whoever's in the planning of all of this, always think about how does it affect their heart? How does it affect that the people to come? Because another thing we always thought of, 7 generations ahead. Right? If we did something today, how does it affect the people in 7 generations to come? Right? Because we have a responsibility to our communities. We have a responsibility back to the people. So again, I admire the work you're doing, and I hear good words. I hope it's all followed by a good heart, and we'll see good and positive things coming about in the future, especially for the Indigenous people of Canada, because again, this is our country. We can't go nowhere else, right? And we're not in those positions yet where we're up here making the decisions. There'll be a few more generations for that, right? So it'll be a few more generations before when we talked about education. You know, we have the highest dropout rate. We don't have large numbers going through university and college with the letters behind your name. So yes, lived experience is so valuable, right? And that needs to be appreciated, accepted, and maybe accredited itself. Anyway, shut up now. But again, thank you.
So maybe just final thoughts from the Parliamentary Secretary?
So, first of all, thank you. And thank you, Beelich, thank you as well. My mother used to tell me that smart people can learn from anybody, and fools who can learn from somebody. And the reason lived experience is so important at the table. And in our presence is because no matter how much you think you know something, you learn something when you listen. And today, the transit idea, we just canceled a tax credit for transit passes in this country. And you know, the NDP is all over us because it was an issue that Jack Layton negotiated with Stephen Harper. And Stephen Harper agreed with it, that may be a reason why you should think twice about why it might be a good or bad idea, but that's just me being a liberal. Which I'm new at. I'm getting better though. But it's the transit. It's an interesting concept because this gets into where good intentions sometimes fall down. So the transit pass in Toronto didn't, because it was the way it was structured as a tax. It the lowest 40% of income earners who had monthly passes didn't earn enough money to claim a credit. So it was a subsidy for the top 60%, while the lower 40% had no access to it. And when we canceled it, people said, oh, but you're adding, you know, $150 a year to the cost of transportation. Yeah, well, we took that money and put it into service so that people who were coming home late at night from a double shift, or students after school, or people who had to go early to work, they didn't have to wait on the side of the road. Women in particular, late at night, in the cold, waiting for a bus. We put that into service rather than subsidizing the top 60%. They said, yeah, but the top 60% is not that rich because transit riders are lower income people than the folks that drive. Said, yeah, that's true. But the 40% who couldn't qualify masks the reality of the poorest of the poor, which are the people who can't afford the monthly pass, or the people who live in smaller communities where there are no monthly passes and have no access to it. The poorest of the poor pay cash, which is the most expensive way to access transit. The monthly pass is a discount for the wealthy. Cash fares are a premium for the quote-unquote casual user. It's actually the person who doesn't have $160 up front, which ties into what you said, that the timing of that support matters because the access to other services is on a similar timetable, and understanding where that should end, on what date in the cycle of a month, is critical for people who live check to check, and I think that's the second lesson there. So discounts on transit have to be figured out. John Tory's move to make kids free is a fantastic initiative. It has massively helped young families getting kids to school, especially low-income kids. So there's some real thought to be done and pursue those ideas. The timing of the check, critically important, and we need to know why it's coming on the 20th. Was that an arbitrary date that was picked by a computer with a or is it the last 10 days of the month when people are most income distressed? We should understand that before we change it, but I think understanding the date and be able to explain it to ourselves, I think, is important. But the final point of moving with head and heart simultaneously is, I think, one of the most profound teachings that is present right across the continent in terms of the wisdom that's being handed down through generation. We need to think our way through this, but we also need to feel our way through this, and we need to do it in a certain sort of harmony. And I think that if we're going to solve the challenges of the next century, that's where it starts. And one other topic, something else, but housing. And this is where I think reducing this, or focusing, maybe reduce it wrong, but bringing this back to a health issue, not an economic issue, is so critically important. Poverty is a health crisis. And when you think of it that way, the rights to health care are already established in this country. You know, housing as a tool to get health, income support as a tool to acquire health, supporting the health of people and the nurturing of the next generation is an act of perpetuating and sustaining health. This was a teaching that was delivered to me by an Anishinaabe elder in Anishinaabe Health, but a gentleman by the name of Joe Hester. He said, you have to understand, as we went into a sweat, as part of this process, to understand. He said, we go into shelter to heal. We go into shelter to sleep. We go into shelter when we're sick. But as a people, we actually live outside. When we're healthy and alive and functioning, we're outside of that shelter. Shelter is a place of respite. And so when you think about building housing with us in our communities, you have to do it as a way of protecting our health. And the reason our health is so critical is if you're not healthy, you don't age. And if you don't age, you can't become an elder. And it's our elders who transmit this knowledge and this teaching. If you want to solve poverty in our community, he said it with a bit of a twinkle in his eyes, create more old people. Which is kind of interesting when you think about it, because that's effectively what the goal of anti-poverty reduction is. We know poverty reduces life expectancy. But what we don't understand when we look at that just as a cold hard fact is that it's the wisdom of our elders, lived through a lifetime of lessons, a lifetime of experiences, synthesizing what's been taught to them, of evolving what's been taught to them, of practicing that, bringing it into ceremony and practice. If we can, as a country, create more old people, we'll, by default, have healthier children. Because you can't get to that age without being healthy kids. And so the programs we have to do, it involves that holistic approach. The anti-poverty strategy, at the end of the day, is a healthcare strategy. And when we look at it that way, the conversation of whether it's right or not, we've already solved that problem in this country. We're proud of our healthcare system. We define ourselves by our healthcare system. That's part of the strength of this country. Our right to healthcare, to universal healthcare, is already enshrined in our Constitution, our Charter. We now have to turn housing into a healthcare strategy. We now have to turn anti-poverty supports and income supports into a healthcare strategy. We now have to turn the health system into producing our elders so they can share those lessons with us. They're on to something. So thank you very much for the opportunity to talk to you today. The minister is all about the data. That's his training, that's his sweet spot when it comes to policy development. We have a round table that's following as part of the strategy as we move from community to community. We've been in other communities to talk to other groups. One of the goals is to make sure that we measure it properly. And for those of you who are in that field, please go to the website that was presented to us. I'm going to get it wrong if I try to quote it. Here, I will find it. It's Government of Canada. Our websites are the longest. We need to get marketing folks to help us. But it's, you'll find it. Sorry. Here it is, www.canada.ca/reduce-poverty. It's really important that you feed into that system. It's not consultation for the sake of consultation. You don't hear about the bus pass and about the timing of these ideas without that input. But in particular on how to measure, what the appropriate sort of mechanisms are there, I think that's one of the most important countries we can make, because we need to know when we're having success and when we're failing, so the precious resources we can assemble up in Ottawa, it's Parkinson's, you all, on the Van Council, or on different community organizations. We need to know what works. Because we don't have a lot of time to get it. We have people asking us that quickly. We have long-term goals, but we need to be able to measure it. And that's one of the most fundamental things the minister asked me to deliver to you today. The mechanisms and the measuring data is really critical to helping us get our jobs done. You know where the data lies, what data you have. Please support us those ideas. Thank you. Wow, this is a great job. I like the Maytag man. I just have to stand here. All right, maybe one last final hand for all four panelists, please. Class dismissed.